Morning, everybody. My name is TD. I'll be the chair for this session, and I would like to introduce Sarah Hoffman. She'll be doing a talk on customizing search for special interest maps. It will be a 20-minute talk and 5 minutes for questions. Thank you.
Thank you, and welcome to this talk. So this talk is aimed at people who might have come to OpenStreetMap because they have some special hobby and found that the general purpose maps never showed what they are actually interested in. Or maybe you're one of the OpenStreetMappers who have mapped the entire city with addresses and streets, and now find they want to make it really complete by, for example, mapping all the trees with circumference, height, and species. And then you might have thinking about making a little website, and you're actually in good company. So there's lots of little maps around for infrastructure, power infrastructure, for hiking, for playgrounds, campsites. You find them everywhere based on OpenStreetMap data. And generally, when you have a map, you actually also want to have a search box. Because people want to actually type in the places they want to find so they can get there pretty quickly. So that's, of course, the search box on the main site. So my name is Sarah Hoffman. I'm actually the maintainer of the geocoder behind this Nominatim. And occasionally, I get a request from people doing special search that they're not really finding the things they're actually presenting on their map. And unfortunately, I have to tell them, well, Nominatim is a general purpose geocoder, so we can't really serve these special interest maps. But there are actually a couple of tricks you can do to improve your search search box, and these I want to present today. So what we're going to do is we're actually building our own little site. In this case, we want to have a special site for mountain peaks. What we have so far is a little map-based map. We're using Leaflet here. Want to show some specialized data, so I chose everything, all nodes stacked with natural mountain or natural volcano. And of course, we want to have the search box, and there I choose one plugin from Per Liederman called Leaflet Control Geocoder, because it's easily extendable, and that's exactly what we want to do. I'm going to use as geocoders only Nominatim or Photon, because I know them best, but actually the principles I'm explaining here, they are true for all the general purpose geocoders around. So if you prefer another geocoder, please do the things I'm explaining today with another geocoder as well. So that's our little site. You see it's still a little bit in the basic stages. At least we have a catchy name already, Pick a Peak. And of course it has a search box. I'm not going to show you any code because that's basically boring. I'm just going to explain you the principles. But everything I'm showing, all the examples you see here, they're actually on GitHub. So you can actually download the repository you see there below and try them out yourself, extend them, use them on your own site. So let's start with the initial problem. Let's try to tune the search engine to get better results for your special interest maps. So having the site, I started out, of course, with just using the general geocoder in our campus Nominatim. And what you can see here, of course, if you type in Heidelberg, you get Heidelberg, the town, because that's what the general geocoder does. But if you look at the very last result, you see, oh, there's also mountains called Heidelberg. And actually, if you have a site about mountains, you might want to show them before you show this little Heidelberg in Australia, I think, which nobody has ever heard about. So that's the first thing we're trying to do. So generally, geocoders have some options to actually allow you tweaking a little bit. And what you have to know here is there's two kinds of options. One is for filtering and one is for ranking. So filtering really means you're throwing out examples. So for Nominatim, for example, you can actually reduce the results to results only in certain countries. So here, if you say country codes DCH, you only get results from Germany and Switzerland. Photon, for example, has something to actually do this by OSM tags. The other options you have, and actually it's not always quite clear which one you get in the documentation, so you have to have a look at it a little bit. So the other option you get is ranking. That means which results actually show up on top of your list. And actually ranking is the magic in the geocoders, and that's very hard actually to get right. So an example for ranking is mostly would use or showing or preferring your cells in your current viewport. So Nominatim can this and Photon as well. So you get still all results from the world, but the ones you're currently seeing on your map are preferred. So let's do this with our filter for now. We actually want to filter this, and both Photon and Nominatim have options for this. We already have seen the one for Photon, which is just OSM tag, natural peak. Nominatim has the same feature, which is actually hidden and not documented, so I'm telling you a secret here. What you can do is just put it in brackets and say the tag, OSM tag you want, and it will also filter by this. So let's see what happens. Trying this with Photon, well, that looks pretty good, right? Now we have lots of Heidelbergs, which are actually natural peaks. Now let's try this with Nominatim, and then something really odd happens. We get Königsstuhl and Auerstein, and there's not a single Heidelberg in there. So what has happened? Actually, we're running into a problem with this is a generic geocoder. And if you do this, say, okay, Everest with natural peak, it finds you the mountains named Everest, and it finds you all the mountains near the place Everest. That's actually what happened here. You got all the mountains near Heidelberg. And Photon actually does the same, but it has a little bit of a different ranking here, and that's why you see there first the results with actually called Heidelberg. So what the problem here is, you're actually using a little bit the wrong tool. So you're trying to basically get in the screw with a hammer. Because geocoders are really optimized for the generic case when they don't know a lot about what people are searching about. They are also optimized for really finding things by name, so not by type. And something that people kind of also are confused about, they don't give you all matches. They're really trying to give you the best matches. So the best geocoder is the one where you always pick the first result it presents. So we need another tool. And the name of the tool is Overpass, actually. That's the one which gives you results by type. So let's pick an easy example for the beginning. So if somebody types volcanoes, what you want to do is show all the volcanoes in the current view. And we can do this with Overpass. So I'm really sucking at the Overpass query language, so I prefer to use Overpass Turbo and just let it tell me what I actually have to do as a query. And you can do this very well with the query wizard. It actually does exactly what you want. So you type in natural volcano and it gives you the query for getting this in a certain bounding box. So we copy this over in our geocoder and there, it works. Now we have an Overpass geocoder, which gives you all the volcanoes, in this case around Napoli, I think. The only problem is it really sucks. The results are not really, before it was really much more beautiful. And now what you can do is, so the problem here is actually that we only get the OSM objects back, which don't have a lot of information. So what you can do is bring back the geocoder. So we know where our mountain is, and what you want to have is a nice location description as we had before. And that's actually what reverse geocoding does. So you have your location, and you want to have this nice description that you had before. Now the problem is a little bit, we have 10 results, and what you would have to do is send 10 requests to the geocoder asking for the location. And there, please be careful, because geocoders generally have some usage terms where you shouldn't send too many requests at once. And of course you know this, because you have to read the usage terms before you used it. Many geocoders have a way to actually do some batch geocoding. And if you have OSM objects, Nominatim does this for you. So there's this totally underused lookup API where you can just put in the IDs of OSM objects and it gives you addresses for these objects. The only restriction you have here, Nominatim has to know the objects. So Nominatim doesn't index every single object, but just mostly the ones which are named. So if your site is too exotic and has objects that Nominatim doesn't know about, this won't work. So basically that means what do we do? When we get our query, we check, okay, what's the name that was typed in? Send an overpass query that matches with the tag. Get the results back, then you filter and sort and just get the 10 most interesting results you have, send it over to Nominatim and show this thing. So, same thing as before, and now it looks beautiful again. And this is the basic principle, how you can use overpass. And now you can actually get carried away doing the weirdest query you ever want. So let's say I want to know the highest peak in the Lake District National Park, just because I've been there last week. And you can do this as well. The interesting thing is now you have this highest peaks thing, which is an overpass kind of thing, because it's searching for objects. And you have this Lake District, which is actually a geocoding problem, because you have to find a place. Well, we can do this. Now it's getting a little bit more complicated. So you pass your query and you see, okay, there's this name in there, Lake District, and you send it off to the geocoder. And hopefully the geocoder is doing his thing right, so you can just take the first result that comes back, and then you have hopefully an area where you have to search your highest peaks in. And this area you send to overpass together with the text you're interested in. So this is the highest peak, or if you want to say active volcanoes, you of course have to state two texts you want to look for. That's no problem with overpass. Again, you get results back, filter, look up the addresses again. And we find, the highest peak in the Lake District, that's the Scaifold Pike. And I looked it up, Wikipedia agrees with me. So this is the basic principle again. You can, of course, now get carried away and combine all this stuff. So say, I'm looking for highest peaks. I find volcanoes in the query. I'm doing this differently. And if none of those matches, you say, OK, no, then I'm sending it off to the traditional geocoder and let them do the work, and we'll see what comes out of it. So hopefully, you're getting the best results that your users might be searching for. The problem with using overpass is a little bit, it tends to be rather slow, at least if you want to use it for geocoding. So it's a really powerful tool, but for example, looking for the highest peaks in Germany, you'll wait in a minute for the result. And nobody wants to wait a minute for the result of their search query. The other problem is we're still not having name search back in, right? And also tied to the fact that it's so slow, you also cannot really do search as your type. So if you really want to get a little bit further here, I'm sorry to say, you have to build your own search database. But that actually doesn't need to be complicated. And that's the other thing I want to show. So of course, you have to have a server then a little bit, but SQLite and Postgres both have text search facilities, which are totally sufficient for these kind of use cases, when you have a very, say, a limited number of objects where you want to have find them by name. So I'm going to present quickly how to do this in these two things. So if you don't have a database yet, I'm really recommending SQLite because it's really easy to install. You can even use it offline if you want. It does give you search as you type. It doesn't give you spelling correction out of the box. The other thing I'm going to present is Postgres, because generally when people start processing OSM data, it ends up in Postgres. It's a little bit more heavyweight. You will also see the queries are more complicated. And it can do actually both search as you type, and it can give you a little bit of spelling correction. What you have to know if you do this yourself is that there are two things to pre-processing the data when you do the searching. One is normalization, and the other is tokenization. So normalization means just throw everything out of the query which is not relevant for actually matching against your database. What is really important to do there is removing capitalization. You probably should also normalize diacritics. And then if you want to go further, you can start looking a little bit at finding abbreviations and lengthening this. So this is something Nominatim does. And, well, spelling correction is then really the master category of normalization, which we're not doing here. The other thing is tokenization, which means basically where is your query split in single terms. So if you don't do anything, this works by space, which for most use cases is totally okay. The problem is with OSM data that it can be a little bit tricky. So name tags tend to be misused. They tend to have the name of the place in there, or you have something, if you say you have restaurants, then often the word restaurants shows up. So you might do something there to do a little bit, get a little bit better results. But my experience is even just using the stuff as it is works pretty well, at least for finding something. So SQLite. So what SQLite has a module called FTS5, so Full Text Search version 5. And this is what we're using here, and this is actually everything included. So what you do is you create a virtual table that actually uses this module, and you can define different columns. So a couple of them are just data columns. So in our case here, we have safety OSM ID and the elevation. And you say it's unindexed because we don't really want to find it. And then you have the columns you actually want to find, and which in our case is just a name, so I call it term here. And then querying the search database is just equally easy. You do a standard select query. If you know a little bit of SQL, you'll understand this. If not, don't worry too much about it. So the interesting term is here that there is a special operation, which is called match. And there it says, OK, go to this FTS5 and do the perfect matching there. There's an interesting little feature, which is this little star at the end of the query, where you can say, I want to actually do prefix matching. And this is what gives us search as you type. So basically, you give the beginning of the word, add a star at the end, and then you can get the results. What you always have to do is this order by. SQLite is really nice to you here. It says, oh, just type rank there, and I'm doing magically the right thing. So it gives you the results in the order of best matches to your query. So we're doing this, and you see this works pretty well. So if you're typing Heidelberg, we get different sorts of Heidelberg. So this is pretty easy, and also pretty fast. If you're doing the same thing with Postgres, it gets a little bit more complicated, although the principle is all the same. So don't worry too much about the details. What you're assuming here is that you already have your data in a table. So in this case here, I have the standard OSM to PGSQL import, having a planet OSM point with a couple of columns. Natural name in Ella is the one that interests us here. And what you do is to get your search table is actually, first of all, we are loading an extension called unextend. This gives us the ability to remove diacritics. And then you create a derived table, which is actually a search table. You could also add a column to your existing one, but let's not make it too complicated. You add all the data columns again that you're interested in. And the juicy part here is adding the column which you can search over. And in this case, we're using the TS vector module. Again, text search here, TS. And this two TS vector function, that's what makes your term into a searchable entity. And this is actually a quite powerful tool, and it can also normalize your terms by language. We don't want to have this now because I actually have the mountains from all over the world. I have no idea what language they're in. So I'm saying, don't do any languages, just do the simple part here. And we're unaccenting it because this is actually not included in the simple module. And then we have our terms. What you always should also do is create an index. And actually for this one, it's a standard gin index with the over the column we have here. So that's creating it. And then to query the database, again, the principle is the same. What we have as operator here is this add function. And what we have to remember here is what normalization you did when you loaded your database. You have to do it when you put in your query term. So we have to first unaccept our term, and then transform it into something Postgres can actually work with its TS vector module. So this is this TS query thing there. And again, here we have the possibility to say, please do prefix matching. So here it's double point star, actually, not only star. And we also have the possibility to rank. You see, it's a little bit more complicated than with SQLite, but same principle. So it basically orders you the results by best match. And we do this here, and you see, looks about the same as for SQLite. Postgres actually has a second module, which is trigrams. We can actually also do text search, but in a little bit of a different way. So what it does is it just takes your word, whatever you have, and uses three consecutive letters, and then tries to find what's the best match against these trigrams. This has the advantage of giving you actually a little bit of spelling correction. So to use this, again, looks pretty much the same as the other examples. What we need is another extension called pgtrigram. And your term column, which you again have to create, you actually have to normalize yourself now completely. So we lower the term, we unexec the term. And the actual interesting stuff here is in the index. So you see there's this little please use GIST trigram ops. That's what actually makes the index use the trigrams. Querying the whole thing, again, other way around. Don't forget the normalization, lower, unexcend. And just for fun of it, we have yet another operator, which in this case is the dollar, the percentage sign, the double percentage sign. And we also have a different operator for the ranking, which is this little double arrow thingy. But otherwise, it's the same. And then, I don't know about you, but I never get the I right in Mount Rainier, and that now works perfectly well. It finds the right mountains. So, which of the two methods you use with Postgres, if you prefer the TS vector or the trigram, depends probably a little bit on your use case. You have to experiment a little bit with it and see what results you prefer. So, search as you type kind of works with trigrams as well. But the results are a little bit better, worse because it's not really a prefix search here, it's just the best match. So I've been using trigrams actually on the Waymark Trail site for hiking, and people seem to be okay with it. So, okay, so from here you actually could take it further, go to the whole way to Elasticsearch, but this is actually something that's really means almost writing your own geocoder. So this is something for the next talk. Just experiment a little bit with it. Remember, think carefully about what your users actually might want to search. And think about what tool best finds it in the way you want to do. That's all for me. Again, a reminder, all examples you can find on GitHub.
Thank you with the enlightening talk, Sarah, and I think now we'll have 5 minutes for questions. Anyone with a question?
Well, thank you very much. I'd like to know if you have any strategies or any tips or hints in how to keep your indexed database up to date with the OpenStreetMap data.
Well, basically, I mean, if it depends on how you get it in. You OSM to BGSQL has the minutely updates, which you can do. If you have your own simple data, it might actually be easier if it's really little data to just recreate it once a night, for example, and do this thing from scratch, because actually getting updates in Zoom, getting minutely updates in there makes things a lot more complicated, definitely.
Thank you very much for this report. It's very interesting, and I'm asking myself whether there are any possibilities of semantically querying or combinations with some semantic search, like I know from the project Sofox and others. So Do you have any hints for this?
Okay, I think there's a posterous model for this, but actually if you want to go this way, I'd really recommend going Elasticsearch, because there is a there are a lot of modules there for going this. But it's, so my experience with geocoding is it's really hard, because you have it's not a full text search. It's words which are taken out of context, kind of, because it's names, right? Proper names. And so what I've heard from people is there's mixed results with this.
Hi. Do you plan to integrate these searches like the trigram into the normal Nominatim, or why don't you?
Sorry, this I didn't.
Do you plan to default tolerant search? Do you plan to integrate it into Nominatim so it would increase the usability for some typos or mistypes?
Typos in Nominatim. Yeah. So basically, now the. If we do this in Nominatim, we're also going the Elasticsearch way. Because, again, this is. So the examples here were for a very limited data set where you exactly know what you're talking about. While Nominatim just has data from all over the world, from very different kinds of objects. And there you really need a full text search there. So the idea there would be to actually integrate Photon on the side. And use this kind of to do a better spelling correction, probably.
Okay, I think now we have come to the end of the session, but if anybody has more questions, I'm sure Sarah can meet you in the foyer in the breakout sessions and answer more. Thank you very much for everybody for attending, and we'll have another session in a few minutes. Thank you.